This week on Reigning in Life Through Faith.
You are the sower of your word. You need to sow word in you so that you can become what God intended for you to become.
Thank you for tuning in to the Reigning in Life Through Faith broadcast. Let's join Dr. Mills as he begins part 6 of Confession is Our Hope.
We have been looking at this subject, confession is our hope. The more I think about it, the more I meditate on it, I'm realizing that anything that we are to accomplish in the way of what God has said that we should accomplish comes as a result of His word planted in us. The word of God in Mark, the 4th chapter, I think is verse 14, it says, the word, the sower sows the word. Let me get to it. I believe that's what it says in Mark, the 4th chapter, verse 14. It says, the sower sows the word. Over in Matthew, the 13th chapter, begins talking about the kingdom of God. And the 3rd verse says, behold, a sower went out to sow. Verse 18 says, therefore, hear the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, then the wicked one comes and snatches away what was sown in the heart. The indication here is that in order for us to, first of all, have the kingdom, that is the governmental rule of God on the inside of us, it's got to be planted in us. Let's look at James 1:21. I think I looked at this last week. I mentioned it last week. I don't know whether I looked at it or not, but James 1:21 says, and this is so important that we get this. It says, therefore, lay aside all filthiness and overflow of wickedness and receive with meekness the implanted word, which is able to save your souls. Which in turn tells me that we have a lot of people in churches, in the body of Christ, who haven't understood that it's their responsibility to plant this word in them so that their souls can be saved. Amen. Now, we read a lot of books, we hear a lot of things, and from an intellectual perspective, you may know some things. But you cannot live out the Word of God from an intellectual perspective. You can only live out the Word of God from what's in your heart. And this word has to be planted in your heart. As it goes through your mind, it cleanses your mind. It also allows you, when it comes back up out of your heart, because your mind is familiar with the Word of God, it then you can live from that. Amen. It says, First of all, we need to understand something. Your soul is not saved. Your soul is something that you need to work on constantly. Because the world around you knows and understands that if I can grab a hold to, if I can get a hold to your soul, I can control you.
That's it. That's it.
All of what we see on TV, here on radio, what we see on billboards, all of that is to do something with your soul. And depending on what you see most, hear most, is what your soul is going to be attracted to, in turn causing your body to do whatever has come into your soul. Your soul is what the devil is after, because if he can control your soul, he can control your body. And if he can control your body, then God cannot have anything to do with you as far as your body and soul is concerned. Now, your spirit might be saved, but you still are not doing in this earth what God wants you to do.
All right. Mm-hmm.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So you're not able to do on earth as it is in heaven, because your body is now being controlled by the adversary, which is controlling your mind. So it's up to you to guard your mind, guard your heart. It's up to you. That's your responsibility. Your responsibility now is really laid out to us in Romans, the 12th chapter, verse 2. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. I like the way that the message says that we should not be, I'm not going to try to quote it. Let's go to it for a minute. The message says, don't become so well adjusted to your culture that you fit into it without even thinking. Instead, fix your attention on God. Now, fix your attention. That's on purpose. You have to do that. You have to fix your attention on God. Through confessing the word, I am intentionally fixing my thinking on God. Through confessing the word. To confess means to say the same thing that God says.
Amen.
I mean, I'm not talking about confessing your sins. Now I'm talking about confessing the word of God. You confessed the word in order to become saved. You didn't confess sins in order to be saved. You confessed the word. What did he say? Confess the lordship of Jesus and you shall be saved. He didn't say confess your sins and you'll be saved. You confess Jesus, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. That word salvation is being delivered from any trouble or anything that you that can confront you. Are you with me? He says now, in this message, he says now, fix your attention on God. Fix your attention on God. Fix your attention on God. God and his word are one. So, you know, I can't come here and say, well, I'm just going to think on God. I'm just going to think about God. If you think about God, you got to think about his word.
Amen.
Because you can't think about God without thinking about his word. You got to think about what he said in order to think about God. Are you with me? Can you understand? And if you don't do that on purpose, you're not going to think about God. You're going to be thinking about all the other things that you're confronted with. You understand what I'm saying? All of these things that you are confronted with, that you're seeing that bombarding your mind daily, those are the things that you're going to be thinking about. Your mind is going to be fixed on the things that you see most or you hear most.
That's right.
So what your mind is going to be fixed on. So you have to, on purpose, fix your mind on God.
Amen.
And that's what I'm trying to get you to do when we talk about confession. Because if not, your mind is going to be on something.
Mm-hmm.
And your mind is not going to be on God.
That's right.
You have to guard your heart.
Mm-hmm.
It's your responsibility to guard your heart. It's your responsibility to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. It's not God's responsibility, because He's given you everything that you need in order to be transformed. Are you with me?
Amen.
And He says now, the rest of this, He says this. He says, fix your attention on God. You'll be changed from the inside out. See, the only way that you can be changed from the inside out is that I got to get it in me. I have got to plant this word of God. I got to plant God in me.
Yes.
Amen. You understand what I'm saying? And if you're not planting God in you, then you're not going to be able to do the things that God wants you to do. Are you with me? And so He says now, instead, fix your attention on God, you'll be changed from the inside out. And most of us, we're kind of like Paul was in Romans, the 7th chapter, where he says, I'm doing those things I don't want to do. You know, the things that I want to do, I'm not doing. Are y'all with me? But the reason that it's done, the reason it's being done, is because you have not intentionally fixed your mind on God. Through confession, intentionally, you can fix your mind on God, and you can be changed from the inside out.
Amen.
From the inside out. But if you're not doing what I'm telling you to do, I'll tell you right now. Joshua 1:8 says, You know, keep this book of the law before you day and night.
Yeah.
Meditate on it.
Yes,
day and night. And then you will be able to do. In other words, what he's saying is that what's going to happen is you're going to be changed from the inside out.
Yeah.
You're going to get this word on the inside of you, and the word on the inside of you is going to cause you to do and to be what God wants you to be. The word on the inside of you will cause you to be successful. The word on the inside of you will cause you to prosper.
Yeah.
But if you don't get the word on the inside of you, that word cannot then cause you, because you don't have any word in you to cause you. Are you all with me?
Yes.
See, a lot of us, we come to church, but we don't really want to do things. We just want to hear a little sermon. We want to be entertained. Are you all with me? Yeah. When you come to this church, oh, we got some visitors in here. And I know this is your first time here, okay? But the next time you come, bring a pencil and pad.
Amen.
And a Bible.
Amen.
I'm expecting for you to come again.
Amen.
Amen. Why? Because there's some things that you need to write down and you need to get implanted in you. If you're going to do what God wants you to do.
Amen.
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 So watch what he says. He says now, you will be changed from the inside out. Readily recognize what he wants from you and quickly respond to it. Unlike the culture around you, always dragging you down to its level of immaturity. God brings the best out of you. Listen to what he says. God brings the best out of you. What is he saying? He's saying when you get the word of God in you, the word of God in you will bring the best out of you. In other words, there are some things in you that you don't even know. I realized this and found out this long time. God has already, it's like a program. God has programmed some things on the in, but what's on the inside of you cannot come out until you get the Word of God in you that now is able to bring out of you what God programmed in you. Are you with me? So you'll never see a lot of things about you that God designed for you until you get the Word of God in you that is able to bring out of you what God put in you. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And you never experience this until you do what I'm telling you to do. Amen. So he says, now, unlike the culture around you, always dragging you down to its level of immaturity, God brings the best out of you. Watch this now. Develops well-formed maturity in you. God does that. What is he talking about? He's talking about this word planted in you will develop things on the inside of you and bring things out of you that you didn't realize that was in you. Are you with me? Okay. Hallelujah. Now, James 1:21. Let's go back over there again. Okay. Let's see, look at this. And then we're going to get to number four in the primary reason why the confession of God's word works for you. Amen. James 1:21 says, therefore, lay aside all filthiness and overflow wickedness. Let me just say something about this right here, because it's hard for you to do, to lay aside anything without the Word of God in you, strengthening you and empowering you to do so. Are you with me? If you could do this on your own, you wouldn't need Jesus.
Amen.
Nobody needs Jesus, you understand, that can do this on their own. So I want you to understand right now, all the things that you struggle with, and you know, everybody goes on these binges, you understand, and they go, I'm going to stop doing this, and I'm going to stop doing that. You can't stop doing nothing.
That's right.
Sure.
And you know it, because you've already tried it about 5 or 6 times. And you see her back doing the same thing. And the reason is because you will never be able to glorify yourself for getting free of anything. The glory goes to God.
Amen.
Are you hearing what I'm saying? And I'm telling you exactly how to do it, because when you plant God's word on the inside of you, I'm not talking about these temporary things that you see. Some people say, well, you mean I can't stop? No, you can't, because it's temporary.
Amen.
But when God does it, it's permanent. That's the eternal life that's taking grip on the inside of you, taking hold of you. When the Word of God says, fight the good fight of faith and lay hold on eternal life. 1 Timothy 6:12. Are you with me? Fight the good fight of faith and lay hold on. That means to take eternal life. Everybody think, I've got eternal life. No. In order for you to have eternal life implanted in your soul, in your body, you got eternal life as far as your spirit is concerned, but you want this eternal life, this life of God, this Zoe life. You want it in your soul, because you don't want to keep missing it. You don't want to keep, I'm going to do this, do it for a minute, and then the next thing you're right back doing the same old things you were doing before. You want a permanency in the things that you want to do. How many of y'all understand what I'm talking about here? Because, you know, the church is full of people who have great intentions. Are you with me? But just don't know how to bring it about. And what I'm presenting to you is how to bring about what God has said you can have.
Amen.
You got to believe God's word. Amen. Amen. We're just not going to come in and sing a few songs and get happy and run around the church and think that everything's okay. You know, get entertained by somebody falling out or, you know, or whatever, you understand? No, that's not helping you at all.
Amen.
Amen. If this thing is real, then we ought to see something real.
Amen.
Are y'all with me? But the only way that you're going to see is that you actually do what the Word of God says do. Are you with me? Glory to God. So James 1:21 says, therefore lay aside all filthiness and overflow of wickedness. Wow. It's an overflow of wickedness. Now, what I want you to understand is that when I confess God's word, this is what I'm after. See, I'm after laying aside filthiness and overflow of wickedness. I remember years ago when I was just teaching Bible studies, and I would tell people, don't worry about stop smoking. Don't you try to stop smoking. Believe God. Because the seed of God in you would deliver you. The seed of God's word in you will deliver you. Are you hearing what I'm saying? See, so when we talk about wickedness and all this other, in order for you to be delivered, it's the word of God. Now you've got to trust that the word of God is going to deliver you.
Amen.
The word of God will deliver you. Are you all with me? And so he says now, and this is how to do it. He says, with meekness, the implanted word, which is able to save your souls. The implanted word. So the word planted in you is able now to save me from this wickedness, this filthiness. The word planted in me is able. Well, maybe some of y'all don't have no filthiness or whatever, you know, you might think. But you got something. Okay, because most of y'all saying, that ain't me. I want to get you where you are. Okay? You may not think what you do is wicked, but God says it's wicked. So that sounds like, oh man, that's just so bad. Well, let's say, for instance, you talk about people. The only thing that's going to deliver you from talking about people is the implanted word. So you get enough word in you and you won't talk about people. As a matter of fact, you'll be, when you talk about them, it will be to encourage them. It will be to bless them. Amen. It won't be to tear them down with your tongue. Because most people don't realize that when you're speaking against other people with your tongue, it doesn't hurt them. It comes back on you. Because you've sown seed that has opened the door to yourself. Amen. Are y'all with me? Can you understand what I'm saying? Yeah. And a lot of other things, you know, we do, you know, getting mad with people and all that kind of stuff. You know, what prevents you from getting angry at people, you know, to the place where, you know, you really want to hurt them is the implanted word. The implanted word. If you know you have a problem, anger problem. Then know this. You don't have enough word in you that has, watch this now. The word right here where it says save your souls, it means to deliver. So you don't have enough word in you to deliver you from anger. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Now, you need to continue to confess God's word. Amen. You need to confess God's word where we see over in Philippians where he says, now, without understanding, you understand the peace of God will come. So I'm going to confess that I have the peace of God. I'm going to continue to confess that I have the peace of God. I'm just telling you right now that when I confess, well, let's go over here for a minute. And then I got to get to what I was doing. This is not my message. No, this is just a little prelude to. Amen. Yeah. Now look at let's look at verse 6 and 7 in 4th chapter of Philippians. Y'all there? Okay. Y'all not there yet? Okay. Y'all know where it is? Praise the Lord. Be anxious for nothing. Be anxious for nothing. Be anxious for nothing. I think that's part of getting mad with people and stuff like that, you know. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your heart. What will guard your heart? Peace guard your heart. Peace guard you. Guard your heart and mind through Christ Jesus. So if peace guards my mind and my heart, I'm not going to get angry. I'm not going to get mad with nobody. Because peace is guarding my heart. Amen. Okay, y'all, that's good. Do y'all hear what I'm saying? Yeah. Now, how's that going to happen? I got this implanted word got to get in me. Yeah. If you know you have an anger problem, and maybe I'm not talking to anybody in here, maybe I'm talking to somebody just watching in by internet. You need to confess God's word. And God's word, then, first of all, you gotta say, I will not be anxious about anything. I confess that I'm not anxious about anything. Father, and I thank you that I've already prayed about this problem. I've already prayed, and I thank you, Father, for answering my prayer. I thank you, Father, that the peace of God that surpasses all understanding. God's my heart and mind through Christ Jesus. I'm confessing that. That word planted in you is going to do something on the inside of you. How many of y'all would, don't raise your hand because you might incriminate yourself. But how many of y'all would really love to be at peace in all situations? Do you understand what I'm saying? The implanted word is what gets you there. And that's why confessing God's word is so vitally important. Because you're after something. You're working on something. Are you with me? Now, we talk about 7 primary reasons why confession of God's word works for you. Last week we talked about number 3. We did 4. Number 4, confessing God's word works for you because it keeps the answer before you. It keeps the answer, and that's what you want to do. Is when we talk about peace, we keep the answer to being upset, get mad. We keep the answer to that before us. Amen. Number 5 is confessing God's word works for you because it changes your heart. What I've been talking about this morning, that word planted in you will change your heart. Amen. James 1:21, we talked about that. We got to get this word planted in us. Amen. Mark 4:14. We are, watch this now. We are the sowers of the word. Our heart is the ground that the word needs to be planted in. Are you with me? Our mouth does the sowing. The sower do what? Sows the word. The sower sows the word. It's my mouth. It's what I confess. It's me confessing God's word. Gave y'all Psalm 91. Did I give y'all that? Yeah. If you want to increase in wisdom and knowledge and things like that with God's word, you want to understand, then you got to go in there and look at it. In Psalm 119, I gave y'all some scripture in there, you know, that you can confess. But you read the Bible and you look in there and you see things. I need to confess this. The Word of God, the Spirit of God will highlight things for you to confess. You personally, because there may be some things that God is working on you with that word planted in you now needs to deal with. Come on, y'all. Amen. Are you with me? And so you confess it, and you don't stop confessing it. You continue to confess it. Sometimes we stop because, man, I'm better than what I was. Right. Yeah, but you haven't arrived. Right. You're just better. And it's easy for you to go back when you stop. Okay. Are you with me? Yeah. So you are the sower of the word of God. You sow the word. I got to thinking about this as the Lord kind of prompted me with this, because when we talk about the sower sows the word and the kingdom of God, you know, and this sowing seed in the kingdom of God and the kingdom of God growing and everything, in most cases, what we're thinking about is somebody who ministers the word, is the sower of the word. In other words, me here now, you know, you don't look at it as this pertaining to you as the sower of the word. You are the sower of your word. Now, I sow the word to the whole congregation. But individually, you need to sow word in you so that you can become what God intended for you to become. Amen. You have to be the sower of the word. And in your own heart, here's what you find out. As we look at Mark, the fourth chapter, we understand that there are conditions in our heart that sometimes we don't even realize is there.
That's right.
And how diligent are you going to be in sowing the word? Are you with me? You'll find out that your heart is hard.
That's right.
And don't want to receive. And you have to keep going at it until your heart, you know, break up that fallow ground in your heart. Amen.
Amen.
You have to be honest with yourself about your own condition. Amen. If you're stubborn, you gotta admit you're stubborn.
Amen.
Stubborn is just another word for rebellion. And a lot of y'all are rebellious people. You're rebellious people. You don't want to change. You want everybody else to change but you. Amen. And you find out that you are rebellious. And then when you realize that you are rebellious, you got to decide that you don't want to be rebellious no more. You got to decide that you're going to speak and declare God's word until God make a change in you.
Amen.
But y'all with me?
Yes.
But you have to decide that. God can't decide that for you. He's given you everything that you need for life and godliness. Now, what you gonna do with it? Are you with me? Can you understand what I'm saying? Yeah. When you realize and see little things in you that you don't like. I mean, y'all, don't raise your hand. But how many of y'all really can really see some things in you at times that you don't like? Y'all gonna raise your hand anyway, huh? Well, when you see those things, and a lot of times we see things and we forget about it until the next time it occurs. But what you need to do is to really take note, write something down. Say, I need to get rid of this. And when you get time, you know, to look in the Word of God and get into the Word of God, you go into the Word of God and find an area where you need to confess the Word of God concerning that particular thing. And you confess God's word so that it's planted in you, and the word of God planted in you can get rid of whatever that is that you saw in you that you didn't like.
Amen. Yeah.
Y'all understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
This is the real life of God that Jesus said he came that you could have.
Yeah.
And have it more abundantly.
Yes.
Well, you're not going to experience what Jesus talked about, this life that he wanted you to experience, without this word being planted in you. This is real, but then I would venture to say that most Christians don't experience it because they really haven't on purpose planted the word of God in you. By accident, you got some words planted in you, but on purpose are you planting words in you so that now you can begin to see the life of God in you being lived through your body, through your mind. Are you with me? Now, so we looked at 4:14. How about Proverbs 4:21-23? I think we looked at this last week, but hey, faith comes by what?
Hearing.
And hearing by what? The Word of God. It doesn't come by having heard. So you might have heard it last week, but you're going to hear it today.
Amen.
Amen. So in Proverbs, the 4th chapter, beginning with verse 20, my son, give attention to my words. Incline your ear to my sayings. Well, I've said this a number of times. You believe what you hear yourself say faster than when you hear somebody else say it. So when you pay attention to God's word, put God's word into your mouth, and speak it out loud. I mean, I'm not talking about hollering. But when you read the word of God, how about this? When you read, do you read out loud? Or do you just read silently? Read out loud. Why? Because you want to hear yourself declaring God's word as you read.
Amen.
You don't have to, listen, you don't have to read fast. I'm trying to comprehend what I read. Your mind need to hear God's word. Your spirit needs to hear God's word. You're going to hear, don't worry, whatever God wants you to hear, you'll be able to hear it. Amen. Are you with me? So he says right here, he says, now, my son, give attention to my words. Incline your ear to my sayings, and do not let them depart from your eyes. Do not let them depart from your eyes. Put your eyes on the word. Keep them in the midst of your heart. The only way I can keep them in the midst of my heart is let my tongue be the ready writer. Let my tongue Write that word on the tablets of my heart. Amen. For they are life to those who find them. And that's something right there. He says, now, you know, it something about that just doesn't sound like, because he says now, for they are life to those who find them. Well, aren't they right here? Yeah. Apparently he's talking about something else. Yeah. He said they're life to those who find them. Right. Yes, sir. Are you listening to me? So just because I see the word doesn't mean I found the word. The words for you have to be found. You just can't read them. Through confessing the word, through out loud reading, God's going to allow you to find some words for you. Are you listening to me? It's kind of like last week when I came in and I was telling you about everything has a voice. And we talk about the blood that speaks. Are you understanding what I'm saying? See, that has to be found. Because, I mean, you read it, but you didn't find it. Are you understanding what I'm saying? And when you find it, all of a sudden it does something on the inside of you. Can you understand what I'm saying? See, it does something on the inside of you. The found word does something on the inside of you. Are you with me? Then look at what he says here. He says now, he says, for they are life to those who find them, and watch this, and health to all their flesh. See, he's not talking about just reading the word. He's talking about these words that you got to find. Hallelujah. These words that has to be found is what brings health to all your flesh. Are you with me? Verse 23 says, keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it spring the issues of life. Out of what? Out of your heart flows the issues of life. Hallelujah. Guard your heart. That means I've got to pay particular attention to the things that I'm allowing to come in. Amen. What are you watching on TV? What are you listening to on the radio? What movies are you going to see? Every movie is not for you to go and see. So you don't even realize what you're doing to your heart. See, and the thing about it is that in a lot of cases we really haven't to its fullest really learned our full makeup. You know how God has created us. And why is it that these things, this just words can affect us in such a great way? Are y'all understanding what I'm saying? And a lot of people don't even believe it. They really don't. Because if they really believe it, then they'd be very particular about what they hear, very particular about what they see, and you know where they go and who they go around, and you know all of that would be something that you would be very particular about. I was very particular when the Lord began to deal with me. I was very particular about the people that I hung around, because I knew the people that I hung around. That's right. Okay. Amen. I knew them. I knew, and I know what they would expect for you to do, being around them. They want you to drink with them, smoke with them, party with them. And if you didn't, then they're gonna talk about you. And if you didn't, then you know, are you really their friend? And some friends you don't need. Amen. All right, let's go back. Let's look at number five. Number five, Romans 12, 2. I already went through that. We got to be transformed by the renewing of our mind. And the way that we renew our mind is through confession. We're renewing our mind. Why? Because Jesus said, the words that I have spoken unto you have cleaned you.
Yes.
Remember, I was looking at Ephesians, the fifth chapter, where a husband has to have the word in order to clean his wife. The reason a lot of guys have a lot of problems with their wives is because they don't know how to clean them. Hey, that's just the word. Word of God says you take the word of God and you wash them and you sanctify them. So you got a husband, wives that don't know how to clean you up, you're going to be the same old person that you were before because he haven't cleaned you. He's mad because you the same old way. You mad because he mad. Well, I'm serious. And he doesn't realize he is the problem. Because he's going to make you be the problem. Because you came from your house, your home, with that mess that he wants you to change, but he don't know how to change it because he doesn't have the word of God that is able to clean you. And you could be married for, I don't care how many years, you know, and people be putting up with one another. You don't have to be putting up with anything if you know how to clean with the word. The washing of the water through the word.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's what it says in Ephesians, the fifth chapter.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. They're everybody mad. Because nobody knows the word.
Yes.
The word of God has to be planted in you. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Matthew, the 12th chapter. Y'all getting anything out of this? I hope so. You know what I would like to see? I would just like to see you all get this word in you and do this word. That's what I want to see. Now, in Matthew, the 12th chapter, verse 34, it says, brood of vipers. Jesus was something, wasn't he?
Yeah.
He said, brood of vipers. How can you, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So that's the reason I said, listen, when you realize there's something in you that you don't like, then you need to get it changed. And you need to confess God's word in order to change it. Because you're thinking about it or think you would like to change, you're not going to change. I don't care how many of these books, these self, whatever books they got out here with these people who think, you know, some psychologist or psychiatrist wrote a book and told you what to do. None of that happens. None of that lasts. I'm telling you now, because that's not the way you're designed. You're designed to function as the, you know, as that little bunny with the battery in it. That little energizer bunny. Well, the word of God is like that battery. That bunny is designed to function based on that battery. You are designed to function based on the word of God, not somebody else's. You can put somebody else's battery in that little bunny, but it ain't gonna last long. The energy has got to be in there.
Amen.
Y'all understand what I'm saying? Yeah. It might last for a little bit, shut down. But you and I are designed. Jesus said this way, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceed out of the mouth of God. That's what Jesus said. And the reason we really don't quite understand is because we didn't realize this word has to be planted in us, and we didn't know how to plant it in us. And I'm trying to help you to get to understand how you plant the word in you. You do it through confessions. Are you with me?
Amen.
And then verse 35 says, a good man out of the good treasure. That word treasure means deposit.
Yes.
This is something, the word of God, what you're doing when you confess is that you are depositing in you so that when it needs to come out, it comes out.
Amen.
So he says, now the good man out of the good treasure of his heart brings forth good things. An evil man out of the evil treasure. So you can deposit rather evil in you, or you can deposit good in you. Are you with me? So he says, you'll bring forth these things out of your heart. What have you deposited in your heart? Are you intentionally depositing good things in your heart? Amen. Look at chapter 13, and we're going to look at verse 52 says, and then he said to them, therefore every scribe instructed concerning the kingdom of heaven is like a householder who brings out of his treasure new and old. So, in order for the kingdom of God to come on the earth, are you with me? The kingdom of God to come on the earth, the kingdom of God that is in heaven to be lived out in the earth, this lets me know that I've got to deposit something. There's a treasure on the inside of me that I've deposited. And that treasure in me deposited has come about as a result of me on purpose sowing the word of God into my heart. On purpose, I confess God's word. On purpose, continually, every time I think about something that I may have done that's not right or whatever, hey, intentionally, what am I doing? I'm confessing God's word. I confess God's word intentionally because I understand what it's going to do for me. Look at Joshua 1:8. I kind of alluded to that earlier. Look at Joshua 1:8. And all in these scriptural references that we go to in a lot of cases, I realize that these are things that is true. And although they are true, we still don't know how to appropriate these things in our lives. Are you with me? And here he says, now, this book of the law should not depart out of what? Out of what? Come on, y'all. This book of the law should not do what? Now, I realize from this right here that what God had his people doing was confessing his word, because he understood what his word confessed would do. Notice what he says. This book of the law shall not do what? Depart from what? From your mouth. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth. In other words, I am going to say what is said in this book. And when I say what he said, that's confessing. I'm confessing what he said. I'm saying what he said. He said, if you say what I say. No, come on. Come on, y'all. He said, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it How often?
Day
and night. So I'm going to confess his word day and night. I'm going to confess his word day and night. Are you with me? Watch this now. Confession means that meditate means I'm going to confess the word. I'm going to keep it before my eyes. You understand? Any kind of way that I can, that word can be before me, it's going to be before me. Are you with me? So then he says that you may observe to do. Are y'all with? Can y'all see this right here? See, a lot of us think that we can just do the word. I read it, I'm going to do it. Word of God says, thou shalt not steal. So, okay, shalt not steal. I'm not going to steal. And most of y'all go to work and you take what, bring home what doesn't belong to you, you stole. Because nobody told you you could have it.
Amen.
But now, when that word gets in you, when you pick up something that doesn't belong to you, the spirit on the inside of you reminds you that that doesn't belong to you. And you'll leave it right there where it is. But until the word of God gets on the inside of you to make you sensitive to your surroundings and the things that you're doing, you just automatically pick up a pen, just put it in your pocket, just go on about your business. Or intentionally, some people. You know, because, you know, when people work for the government just think, okay, well, this belongs to me because I, you know, this is my tax dollars.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
My tax dollars paid for this. Hello. I know some of y'all been there. Y'all laughing because y'all been there. You been there.
Skillcraft.
And you realize, you steal it. And when you steal, you don't realize that you're opening the door to the adversary to steal from you. Are you with me? Yeah. Now look at this. Look at what he says. He says now, to observe, to do according to all that is written in it. So if I want to do what is written in God's word, if I want to do what God wants, I'm going to have to confess. I'm going to have to keep this word in my mouth. Are y'all with me? And then he says this. This is God's promise. For then, when, after, you've kept the word of God in your mouth. You've meditated day and night on the word after that. You know, some people think just because they made Jesus their Lord, everything changed. Because your mind haven't changed. Your mind is still the same old mind. Your mind is still taking you down the same old places. You thought you could stay out of the club, but you can't stay out of the club because you haven't had the word of God that you meditated on day and night. You think you could stay out of somebody else's bed. But you can't stay out the bed. Somebody's bed that doesn't belong to you. Somebody you're not married to. The reason you can't is because you haven't fortified yourself with the word of God. And your body's just doing what it just normally did. Christian, you know, you made Jesus the Lord. You know, I've said, Jesus is my Lord. And you laid up in the bed with somebody else. But then still, you know, I love the Lord. Jesus is my Lord. Are y'all with me? Can you understand what I'm saying? No, it just doesn't happen just because you made Jesus your Lord. On purpose, you got to do what the Word of God says do.
Amen.
See, if you want to change, change is not change until you've changed. You haven't changed just because you made Jesus the Lord of your life. If the same old things that you were doing before you made Jesus the Lord of your life, you're still doing now, you haven't changed. Are you all with me? So, I'm going to look at this. I see zeros that just popped up. For then, you will do what? You will make your way. Well, let me tell you something. You are not making your way prosperous. It's that word that got in you that makes you prosperous. And then you will have good success. Are you listening to me? Y'all with this?
Yes.
See, this has really not been taught like this for you to understand. It's very easy. The easiest thing is to confess the word of God and let God do the rest. It's very easy, but we make it hard. We make a lot of things hard on us because we're trying to do it our own self, in our own strength. And the word of God says, you can't do it in your own strength and then give God glory for it. The ways of a man seem right, but the end thereof is death. I got to stop because my time's up.
Thank you for tuning in to today's Reigning in Life Through Faith broadcast. If you're in the D.C. metropolitan area, Dr. Mills invites you to join our encounters every Sunday morning at 9:30 a.m. and every Wednesday evening for our 7:30 p.m. Bible study. If you cannot join us, we invite you to visit our website and watch us live at agapeembassy.org. Like or follow us on our social media pages for up-to-date information on what's happening in the ministry and encouraging posts that will bless your life through the week.